All right, good morning, church. I'm going to lower this down because I'm, like, shorter than everybody else here. So, all right, how's everybody doing this morning?
Come on, Bobby.
All right. And so, like everybody said, my name is Bobby. I'm a part of the campus ministry. Woo! And so I know we got a lot of campus students in the house. We got a few marrieds here, some young professionals. And so it's exciting to see a younger crowd, amen? This is awesome. But what I'm going to be talking about today, and let me get this really quick. Here we go. I'm going to be talking about God Can, right? We've been going through this series in the past couple weeks about God Can, right? And I'm going to be talking about the life of Paul today. You know, it's been really awesome. I've been studying out the life of Paul here the past couple days and just growing a lot and seeing his life and what he did, right? And the man that he was and who he became. You know, and I think about this idea of God Can. There's so many moments throughout Scripture, right? God Can moments, like parting the Red Sea. You know, these type of moments that were only God can do this, right? You know, and that's kind of our theme. That's what we've been going through is God Can. You know, and for me, I started looking at this and I said, man, the story of Paul is the most incredible story that I think that God can do in somebody's life. I think it's the most incredible thing we can see that God can, you know. And, you know, the truth is, I think we love to see things go from a bad place to a good place, right? I think that's kind of a cool idea, you know. Does anybody love to do chores here? Anybody love cleaning? All right, we got a few, right? If anybody knows me, I love to clean. It's really weird. I'm like the guy that, like, I love doing dishes just because I love it, right? And everybody else is like, oh, we'll keep them in there. And you got this huge pile, right? This gigantic double sink full of dishes. And I'm like, I wake up in the morning and the first thing I'm like is, I'm just going to clean these dishes, right? I don't know why. It's weird. It's weird, especially living with some of the guys because they're like, man, I love having you around the house. I'm like, all right. You know, for me growing up, I used to love mowing the grass. That was one of the things that I got enjoyment from. You know, because you got this yard that's, like, up to here. Like, you see me walking through it, and it's like I'm in a jungle, you know, because I'm, like, 2 foot nothing. And so I'm walking, right, you know, but you see mowing the grass, right, because you can see all the lines. And you look at it afterwards, and you can just sit down, and, you know, you got grass all over you, and your shoes are, like, green. They were once white, now they're, like, bright green because of the grass. And you can sit back, and you can look, and you go say, man, this looked terrible before, but now it looks awesome. And then you have people over and you can throw a party and they're like, man, your grass looks great. You're like, that was me right there. I got the shoes to prove it, right? You know, but we love to see these things go from bad to good, right? We love to see things get changed, you know, and the truth is, I think, you know, God can change our lives. God can change the lives of everybody in this city and in this world. And I think Paul's life shows an incredible example of that. Remember, I remember being a freshman at UTSA. You know, we got some roadrunners in the house. Beep, beep. I think that's how you do it. There you go. I kind of forgot. I'm used to giving the gig-em, right? You know, but I was a freshman at UTSA, and I remember studying the Bible, and I remember going through Paul's life. That was almost 5 years ago now, and I remember looking and going, man, this guy, he went from such a bad place, and he did so much for God, all because God can. You know, and I hope that this inspires you this morning, that God can do amazing things in your life and in the lives of people around us. So if you have a Bible, let's turn over to 1 Timothy chapter 1, and we're going to dive in here. In 1 Timothy chapter 1, we're going to start in verse 15. It says, here is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst. But for that very reason, I was shown mercy, so that in me, the worst of sinners, Christ might display his immense patience as an example for those who would believe in him and receive eternal life. You know, we see here, these are Paul's words, right? He's writing about who he was, right? And what God did through him. You know, Paul's story is one of the most incredible examples of what God can do. You know, the scripture says that what Christ did, it was all the way back in 33 AD, right? I tried to do some basic math. You know, I have a college degree, so I can add and subtract a little bit. That's 1,984 years ago, right? That is a long time ago. But what God did in Paul's life almost 2,000 years ago, it sets an example for us today. And that's incredible. That, to me, was shocking, that his life can set an example for us. And the truth is, you know, we love examples, right? Yeah. We love examples, too. Remember, I was really young. I think we were all young once, right? But I remember a time when I was really young, and I have three older brothers, and so we were kind of the kids in the block that liked to do all the crazy stuff, you know. And I remember one day, this was before my mom and my dad came home from work, and we had a trampoline, right? You know, as a kid, the trampoline's like one of the funnest things you can have, because you can do so much with it, right? But I remember we had a trampoline, and we found a way to get on top of the house. And so we were like, all right, we're about to do some crazy stuff here. And so I remember my brother, he was a little bit, you know, bigger than the other three of us. And we're like, Andrew, you go jump off the house first. You know, I want to see you do it, right? And we're all chickens, and we're sitting back, and we're like, oh, okay. And so we have my brother jump up there. And this guy, just his heart was awesome. He goes, all right, doesn't even think about it. Runs and just, like, jackknives off of this house. And he hits the trampoline, right? And what did he do? He sunk all the way down till his butt hit the floor. And he's like, boo! And he's like, oh, my butt! You know, and so he gets up, and we're like, we're not doing that, you know? We're not doing that. We saw his example, and we're not doing that now, right? You know, and I think it's crazy. We love examples, right? We have infomercials. Every infomercial is an example that this product can work. And a lot of times they don't, right? You know, but we love examples, don't we? We need to see them in order to have the faith, in order to say, hey, I'm going to do this myself. And we love examples. And the truth is that Paul was an example for us. He set an example for us that we can be changed by God. You know, and my first point for us this morning is that God can change the unchangeable. You know, back in 1 Timothy, Paul states here that he was the worst of sinners, right? You know, I read this and I said, man, Paul, you're kind of boasting about your weaknesses, right? I was like, man, you know, you're not the worst of sinners. Like, you know, but we look at this and he says, man, I am the worst of sinners. And I think the truth is he had reason to say that. And we've got to look at that. So in Acts chapter 22, in verse 1 through 5, I'll have some of these on the screen here. But it says, brothers and fathers, listen now to my defense. When they heard him speak to them in Aramaic, they became very quiet. Then Paul said, I am a Jew born in Tarsus of Cilicia, but brought up in this city. I studied under Gamaliel and was thoroughly trained in the law of our ancestors. I was just as zealous for God as any of you are today. I persecuted the followers of this way to their death, arresting both men and women and throwing them into prison, as the high priest and all the council can themselves testify. I even obtained letters from them to their associates in Damascus and went there to bring these people as prisoners to Jerusalem to be punished. Right? Paul's stating here what he used to be. That, you know, you look at this and you can get confidence that, man, he really did have a reason to say he was the worst of sinners. You know, the first part, he says he was a Jew born in Tarsus, right? He studied under Gamaliel and was trained in the law, right? You know, how does Paul's upbringing set an example for us? You know, Tarsus was one of the most influential cities in that time of Asia Minor. It was known for its universities, right? You know, College Station is known for what? Texas A&M, right? You know, it was known for its universities. You know, and he grew up in a very strict Jewish household. They were very strict in what they studied and the law of Moses, right? And he had very, very prestigious credentials there. You know, at the age of 13, Paul studied under Gamaliel. And if you guys look in Acts 5, verse 34, he had a reputation. Gamaliel had a reputation among the people for who he was as a teacher. You know, and you look at these things and you say, man, okay, so he was born of these things. How can that make him the worst of sinners? Let's go to Philippians chapter 3, verse 4 through 7. It says, if someone else thinks they have reason to put confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, in regard to the law, a Pharisee. As for zeal, persecuting the church, as for righteousness based on the law, faultless. But whatever were gains to me, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. You know, and these were the things that Paul could have taken pride in. Yeah. He could have taken pride in his upbringing, right? He could have taken pride in his family and how they raised him, or even his credentials and what he studied, you know? And I think this helps us because we can do the exact same thing, can't we? You know, we can have a hard time approaching God and seeing that God can change us because we take pride in what we have done. We take pride in our accomplishments, right? Maybe some of us were raised in a Christian household, you know, and we can take pride in that, saying, man, I was a good kid growing up. I was a good person, right? I didn't do all those bad things that everybody else claims to do. I'm good, right? We can take, you know, we can take pride in even our degrees and our success, right? Many of us here go to A&M, and it's known for being one of the most prestigious universities, right? We can take pride in that. And the truth is, that can stop us from seeing that God can change, that God can change us. You know, and if you're anything like me, I can definitely do this. You know, and this could have stopped Paul. And the truth is we have to realize that can stop us too. You know, and then the second thing is, he says that he was just as zealous for God as any of you are today, right? He says, I persecuted the followers of this way. You know, the truth is, guys, Paul's life was marked by religious zeal. You know, brutal violence, relentless persecution of the early church. You know, what was crazy, that I studied this out and I said, man, the whole time Paul was doing this, he thought he was glorifying God. The whole time he was persecuting the Christians, he thought he was glorifying God. You know, and he believed that the Christian movement, right, was dangerous to Judaism, that he had grown up believing. You know, and it's funny. Have you guys ever been so convinced of something, but you're completely wrong?
Oh, yeah.
You know, you're so convinced. I remember when me and my fiance Alexis, when we started dating almost a year and a half ago now, I remember it was like one of the first couple weeks, and she came over to my work. I worked at the La Quinta Hotel off Graham, and she came and she brought me food, and my boss and her husband were there, and so I was like, hey, I want you to meet my boss. You know, that'd be kind of cool. And so we start talking, and she looks at him, and she goes, or something like that, but she called him hubby. You guys know what hubby is? Like husband, right? I had no idea what that meant. I had no idea what hubby was. I'd never heard that growing up. And so I'm over here, and we're thinking of nicknames. You know, when you start dating, you're like, oh, what can we call each other? Like babe, all this kind of stuff, right? You know, and so we were thinking of nicknames. And so I was like, hey, you should call me hubby.
No.
And we had just started dating. Just started dating. And it was so funny because I had no idea what that meant. I was like, call me hubby, that's funny. Like, they're doing it. You know, so we should do it. You know, and I was so convinced in my mind that that was a good nickname. And she's like, she just got bright red, and she's like, what? I'm over here like, why are you blushing? Like, I don't look that good, you know? But it was funny, you know? And it wasn't until, I think, a couple days later, or maybe the next day, but I was hanging out at the guy's house, and Brett, actually, I told him about this, and he just looks at me, and he's like, oh, man, what are you doing? And then he explained to me what hubby meant, and I was like, oh, I'm so dumb. Oh, man. And so, you know, but we know what that feels like, right? We feel that, man, I'm so right. I know I'm right. But in reality, we're not. And that's how Paul was, guys. Paul believed that what he was doing was right. He believed that persecuting the church and persecuting Christians on a daily basis, throwing them in prison and punishing them was the right thing to do. But in reality, he was completely wrong. And that's exactly why God had to come down. Jesus had to come down and tell him and show him. You know, he was convinced. You know, and the truth is, guys, that we can be convinced of the wrong things too. And the truth is, that can stop us just like it could have stopped Paul. That can stop us from seeing the truth and can stop us from really changing and being like what the Bible calls us to be. You know, we can come into church, we can think, man, I have these preconceived notions of who Jesus is and what it means to follow him. You know, but we've got to throw those things off and look at, what does the Bible really say?
Right.
What does the word really say about following him and what God can do through us? You know, in Galatians chapter 1, verse 13, you can look a little bit more here. It says, for you have heard of my previous way of life in Judaism, how intensely I persecuted the church of God and tried to destroy it. Acts chapter 8, verse 1 through 3, it says, and Saul approved of their killing him. This was actually when Saul approved of the stoning of Stephen and killing him. You know, it says, on that day, a great persecution broke out against the church in Jerusalem, and all except the apostles were scattered throughout Judea and Samaria. Godly men buried Stephen and mourned deeply for him, but Saul began to destroy the church. Going from house to house, he dragged off both men and women and put them in prison. You know, this is who Paul was. He was a persecutor of the church, right? He killed Christians. He did these things, right? He put people in prison. You know, and that's exactly who he was. And Paul zealously went after ending Christianity. His life was dedicated to destroying the things that God had been building. You know, we may look at this and go, well, I'm not like Paul, right? Because I'm not doing those things. I'm not out there persecuting Christians and doing all of those things, right? So we can sit and go, oh, I'm just going to throw this lesson out the back. But the truth is, that's what sin does. That's exactly what sin does to us, is it destroys the very thing that God has been trying to build in your life. The very thing that God's trying to make you into be, sin destroys that. As God was trying to build his church and start a movement on this earth that would last for eternity, Paul was trying to end it. You know, and that's why I think the story of Paul is so amazing. The most amazing example of God can, because it shows us that if God can take someone like Paul and change them into a world changer, then he can do the same in our lives. No matter what people may do, no matter what mess they are in, God can change the unchangeable. Amen. Amen. And so let me ask you guys, do you feel unchangeable today? Do you feel like, man, no matter what God does, his infinite power, who he is, he can't change me. I've got too much going on in my life for God to change me. Do you feel that this morning? You know, we can walk into church feeling those things. Or maybe you walk into church and you say, hey, at least I'm not like that guy. You know, God, you've blessed me way more. And at least it'd be good for me to be on your side, God. You know, you'd be privileged to have me on your team. We can walk in with the pride in our heart. Or we can walk in feeling like God can't change us. You know, and the truth is, guys, Paul sets an example of both of these contrasting ideas. He had pride to take, and he had many things that could have stopped him from changing. But what did he do? He let God change him, and he went through with it. You know, and it reminds me of a story, this idea, you know, of being the worst, right? You know, Paul says here that, man, I'm the worst of sinners. It reminds me of being in high school. Did anybody play high school sports? Anybody? Yeah, so maybe we had some high school sport athletes there. Reminds me of one of my buddies, Wesley. He was my best friend in high school. And, you know, we came in out of junior high. We came into high school trying to figure out the sport we're going to play. You know, we had played football for a little while, played a little basketball. Don't know why they let me on the basketball team, because I was, like, tiny. But I was on it, and it was awesome. JV team. Whoop! You know? But me and my buddy Wesley, we were these two scrawny little kids coming out of junior high, right? You know, we hadn't grown into our muscles yet and all these things. But, you know, he was like 5'5", 120 pounds, this tiny little kid. And I don't remember how tall I was, really small. But I remember we found this sport, water polo. Many of you guys know that I used to play that. And I remember going to our first practice. And it was the most horrible, atrocious practice that you've ever seen. Because we're over here, we can't even swim. We're like drowning, you know. We're trying to swim, we're like, oh, you know, we can't do it. You know, and we had no idea how to play water polo. We had no idea how to swim properly, you know. But we wanted to play, right? We wanted to get on the team, and we wanted to do something awesome because football would have torn us apart, right? So we tried out, and I just remember how bad it was. We were terrible. But the cool thing was that the coach that stuck through high school with us actually transformed my best friend Wesley. He went off to the Naval Academy, graduated out of high school. Went off to the Naval Academy, which they're in a D1 division, and they're usually around top five, top six in NCAA schools for water polo. So if you go to the school to play water polo, you're one of the top of the top. And you look at that 4 years prior, you got this scrawny little kid that can barely swim, and now he's playing at a top-tier D1 NCAA school playing water polo. And I looked at that, and I was like, man, what did that? What did that? And I looked back and I said, man, we had a really great coach. We had a really great coach that stuck in there, didn't kick us off the team at the beginning, right? He had a vision. He thought about, man, these kids can become something else. They can become something great. And the coach helped and hung in there. And the truth is for us, guys, if we say, man, I am the worst, we might feel that right now. Man, if I am the worst right now, God's going to hang in there with you. God's going to hang in there with you and help change you into who he's called you to be, you know. And you know, we look at the things going on in our lives, we see the sin, the pain, all these different things, and we can get discouraged, and we can say, man, I am the worst. But God hangs in there. He's devoted to every single person on this earth. Do you think that way this morning, That God's not only working in your life, but he's working in the lives of your neighbors, of your coworkers, of the kids that are sitting in the class next to you. That he's working in their lives too, because God believes he can change even the unchangeable. You know, and the story of Paul is just that, that he can change the unchangeable. And he created us to change this world, amen? And that leads me to my second and final point, that God can use the unusable. And so let's take a look at who God really made Paul to be and how he used him in this amazing way. So in Acts chapter 19, if you guys will turn over there with me. Acts chapter 19 and verse 11. This gives an example, and this shows what God did through Paul in his life. And just a small glimpse here, it says in verse 11, Acts 19, verse 11, says, God did extraordinary miracles through Paul, so that even handkerchiefs and aprons that had touched him were taken to the sick, and their illnesses were cured, and the evil spirits left them. You know, it's crazy to think where Paul came and what God did. He did extraordinary miracles through Paul. He went from Paul, who used to persecute the church and persecute God, to doing miracles. That's incredible that God did miracles through him. You know, if you look over in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, we're going to go through a lot of scripture here because Paul, honestly, is throughout a lot of the Bible. 1 Corinthians 15, starting verse 9, it says, For I am the least of the apostles, and do not even deserve to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace to me was not without effect. No, I worked harder than all of them. Yet not I, but the grace of God that was with me. You know, Paul became a very humble man. You see, the pride in his early life, and he became a humble man. And a very, very hard-working person. Hard-working than any other person during that time. It says he worked harder than them. So he was able to get that pride out of his life and become very humble. He can do the same for us today, amen? Acts chapter 28 and verse 31, it says, He proclaimed the kingdom of God and taught about the Lord Jesus Christ with all boldness and without hindrance. You know, Paul, he became a bold proclaimer of Jesus. He went around and he proclaimed who Jesus was to the Gentiles. In Romans 1, verse 14, it says, I am obligated both to Greeks and non-Greeks, both to the wise and the foolish. This is why I'm so eager to preach the gospel, also to you who are in Rome. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes, first to the Jew, then to the Gentile. You know, up to this point, the Gentile nation hadn't been reached. It had been reached very seldomly. And God used Paul to go and reach the other entirety of the world. Without that, these Gentiles, many of us in this room, probably mostly all of us, wouldn't be here. But God changed Paul's life, and he used him to reach those people. And by the grace of God, we're here too, right? You know, and it's because of what God can do in Paul's life. In 2 Corinthians chapter 12, it says, Therefore, in verse 7, Therefore, in order to keep me from becoming conceited, I was given a thorn in my flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me. Three times I pleaded with the Lord to take it away from me. But he said to me, My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest on me. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weaknesses, in insults, in hardships, in persecutions, in difficulties. For when I am weak, then I will be strong. You know, Paul, here, what God changed him to be, he became a man who, though he had weaknesses of his own, took delight in hardships. You know, he became a man that wasn't brought down by hardships. He wasn't brought down by what's in his life. He took delight in those things because it glorified God. That's who God can change us to be, you know? And if you guys didn't know, Paul wrote about 13 of the New Testament books throughout the Bible. And so many of the stuff that we read throughout the scriptures today came from Paul. So God used him to do that. You know, and I think about this idea, you know, that no matter where we're at, right, God can change us to help change this world, you know. And it's kind of like one of these, right? It's kind of like an old pencil, right? An old chewed-up pencil. You know, you look at this, it's got like bite marks, and the eraser is almost completely gone. You know, it's tiny, so you can't really sharpen it, but maybe with like a knife or something. But it's like, you know, have you ever been sitting in class and you get there for your test and you're like, oh, I don't have a pencil. How can I take my test, right? You know, but you're searching and everybody next to you doesn't have one, right? But you're like, oh, my faithful, trusty pencil, right? And it's in the bottom of your backpack. It's got like the dirt from the bottom of your backpack on it, you know, and you're digging and you're frantically looking because the time's running out as you're taking your test, right? And you're like, oh, there it is. And you pull it out. It's like an inch long. But it does the trick, right? It does the trick. Even though it's beat up, it's been used 1,000 times, it doesn't have anything left to it. It does the trick to help you take your test. And the truth is that we can be like this. We can be like an old chewed up pencil, right? The old faithful trusty pencil, right? We might have bumps. We might have bruises. We might have things in our life that can stop us from getting to God. But it's crazy because it comes in clutch. That pencil comes in clutch when you need it. And God can come in clutch in our lives. He can come in and change our lives and use us to do incredible things. He can use us to change this world. You know, just as broken as this pencil is, we may feel the same way, but God uses that. He uses our weaknesses as Paul did. He uses the bite marks. He uses the bruises. He uses the pain to help change other people because people feel the same stuff that we do. You know, and God used Paul in such a powerful way. Do you think even handkerchiefs, even aprons that touched him used to heal the sick? You know, that's a miracle. You know, and I remember when I first read, you know, I thought that when I first read that, I thought, man, Paul's got some really bad BO if he can, like, cure even evil spirits by just touching an apron, right? He must have some really bad stank on that apron to be able to make demons come out of people, right? You know, I thought that was funny. I was like, man, yeah, he must smell pretty bad, but no, it wasn't his smell, right? I used to have a roommate. Many of you guys might know him, but he used to run track. And he would come in our house after track practice, and he would just, you know, do one of these, like kick your shoes off and throw them across the room. And he'd sit down. Within like a matter of 10 seconds, everybody's just running. Like, what is that smell? Where is he at? Oh, you know? And you just start running. You desert, right? Because it just smells so bad. It's that stank, right? It's that bad BO. You know, and the truth is, God used Paul to heal people. God used Paul by even just an apron that touched him. He became a man that had healing BO. Is that you today? In a funny way, is that you guys today that even if something touches you, God uses that to heal other people? Maybe your family. Maybe if you have a friend that comes and sees your family and how you love your kids, you love your wife, your husband, they take a step into your life, it will change them forever. Is that your marriage today? Maybe it's your work ethic and going through school. Man, you know, I got a friend that comes in and he sits with me and while I'm studying. And they say, man, this guy works harder than anybody I've ever met. And he follows God. It's got to be him. It's got to be God. You know, when people touch your lives, when people come close to you, are they changed? Just like when the handkerchiefs that Paul touched changed other people. Is that where we're at today? You know, the truth is, it's an amazing example of how God can use the unusable. And so I just want to encourage us here this morning. You know, let me ask you, do you believe that God can use you like this? Do you believe that in your heart of hearts, right? Do you believe that God can use you to change this world? Do you believe that God can use you to reach people that are next to you and to show them that Jesus is the way? And that they have something more to live for, right? No matter where they're at, no matter what sins in their life, you can be used by God to change them. You know, and whose life will you impact today? Whose life will you touch today? And in Ephesians chapter 2, starting in verse 8, it says, "For it is by grace you have been saved, through faith. And this is not from yourselves, it is a gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." You know, as Paul writes here to the church in Ephesus, that you and I were created to do incredible things. You and I were created to be world changers. Not by works, not so we can take pride in anything that we've done, the accomplishments that we have, right? But it's a gift that God uses us. Because it's a gift. It's a gift that we can be used by God. And that we're his handiwork. And so what will you do knowing this morning? What will you do? Will you walk out of this room and say, man, I'm going to be used by God to change this world, and I'm going to do whatever it takes. Even if it's hardship and persecution like Paul went through, are you gonna have that mentality? I'm going to go help somebody. I'm going to change the world, you know? And will you walk out of here saying, man, God can really change me? God can. He has the power. If there's one message I want to give you guys this morning, God has the power to change you and I and the rest of the world. Amen.